Alright guys, this is Mr. TARDIS and welcome to Mr. TARDIS Reviews. Now before I get started on this review, there's something I've been meaning to talk about for the past few weeks that I keep forgetting to bring up. So let's talk about the new intro sequence.
Okay, so for Series 7 we're getting new opening credits every week, and the Doctor Who logo gets a unique texture added to it, depending on what's happening in the episode. First things first, there's nothing wrong with the idea of changing the texture of the logo, I actually like that idea, but the rest of the opening just looks so cheap and tacky. It's clearly just the normal Series 5 and Series 6 opening, but with strange filters to add different colours to the time vortex, as opposed to creating a new opening from scratch. The colour changes just look fuzzy and the colours are too saturated. It genuinely looks like something I could do on Windows freaking Movie Maker. Also, the way the actors' names appear just looks dull. They just fade in and there they are. The original opening was like, yeah, Matt Smith is in this and so are these guys, yeah, let's go on an adventure. Whereas here it seems like, yeah, this actor's in it and yeah, there's this person. There's no sense of wonder or excitement. While the original opening made me goddamned excited to be watching the show, these opening credits make me want to fall asleep. Oh, and incorporating the BBC logo underneath the title, and then having the logo just sitting there for a few seconds, it kind of diminishes the effect of the Doctor Who logo. So yeah, keep the texture changes, but incorporate the TARDIS into the logo like before, get rid of the BBC logo, and add that to the original opening from Series 5 and Series 6.
So, now that I've got that out of the way, we can now talk about Doctor Who, Series 7, Episode 3, A Town Called Mercy.
The episode takes place in 1870s Nevada, in a town called, well, Mercy. The Doctor, Amy and Rory find themselves in this town which has been gripped in fear, and they're being held against their will by a cyborg gunslinger, played by Andrew Brooke, who is apparently Karen Gillan's boyfriend in real life. The gunslinger is after a doctor named Kala Jex, played by Adrian Scarborough, who created him in order to end a war on his planet, but is now being hunted by the cyborg for revenge, despite him helping the citizens of Mercy. The doctor must decide whether or not to let Jex live.
From that brief description, you can tell that this moral issue isn't going to be very simple, and since it's the focus of the story, then let's focus on that first.
Now, I need to say this, there's no sugarcoating it, and no one should even be trying. The moral dilemma in this episode doesn't work. I'm sorry, but it simply doesn't. But let's give a bit of context. This episode was written by Toby Whithouse, who wrote The God Complex last season. I mentioned in my review of that episode that Toby is a writer who knows exactly what he wants his audience to feel and what emotions he wants to wring out of them, but he cuts many, many corners and contrives reasons within his scripts in order to get there. However, in A Town Called Mercy, those same corners have been cut, but this time it's clear that Toby has no idea what emotions he wants his audience to feel. Now let me stress, I have a massive amount of respect for Toby for trying to tackle this issue, because it's not an easy subject to get across, but it just doesn't work with what he's presented here, and Toby just took the easy way out in the end. Jax is a war hero on his planet, and he has helped end a 9-year war by experimenting on soldiers against their will to turn them into weapons. That already creates a complex moral dilemma, but then it gets even more complex when we discover that Jax crash-landed in Mercy while being hunted by the cyborg, and has not only helped the townsfolk by providing heat and lighting, but also is their doctor and has saved their lives from illness. That makes things even more complex. Then it turns out that Jex isn't the mild-mannered and nice person we met at the beginning, but he's actually quite a bitter asshole. But then we discover that Jex is actually a spiritual person, and believes in a horrible afterlife that awaits him, and he is truly repentant for what he's done.
You see where this is going, right? Now, I respect Tony for trying to make this a complex issue, but with so many layers in such a short amount of time, many of which work against each other, something has to give.
Jex's bitter attitude towards the Doctor goes against his nice nature at the beginning. His frantic, megalomaniacal delivery when he tells everyone he's a war hero goes against his spiritualistic nature. There's far too much going on under the surface for this character, creating a moral dilemma that's far too complex for complexity's sake. Add on top of that a town that's kind-hearted and didn't ask to pick a fight with anybody.
We don't got any ill feeling toward the Doc, we just think about our families.
And you're left with far too much to think about. I respect the idea, but the delivery just cripples any chance of a strong bond. It almost seems like Toby wrote Jex as a clearly bad person in many sequences, just to try and simplify everything and make things more black and white, but that just goes against what the episode is trying to get across. In an attempt to make things simpler, he just made it nonsensical. It's one thing to make the morals vague, it's another to make them cluttered.
These strange moral attitudes even extend to the Gunslinger, and when you think about it, the Gunslinger should be the simplest character.
Okay, so we're told that the Gunslinger is programmed to take lives only when absolutely necessary. Yet he's willing to shoot an unarmed and harmless Rory and the Sheriff, Isaac. He was even going to have a shootout with the Doctor. The Gunslinger also put up a border around the town, which he made out of rocks and branches. Remember, the Gunslinger created that border himself. Remember that. Okay, so he did that so that innocents couldn't get hurt. Yet he has no problem crossing the line at the end of the episode, and he's easily able to control his actions and aim incredibly well when he does come in to kill Jex. Remember, the Gunslinger created that border, so it's not like the town did it in order to keep him out or make some sort of a bargain with him. The townspeople seemed more than willing to throw the Doctor over the line, so the Gunslinger could have just easily crossed the line to get to Jex because the townspeople were more than willing to give him up, so... what's the point of the line? Why did the Gunslinger create it? There's no danger in human shield because the townspeople in Mercia are more than willing to hand Jex over, with the exception of Isaac, but the Gunslinger could just easily overpower him without killing him.
The point I'm trying to make is, what is the Gunslinger's moral code? If we don't understand that, then it's really hard to sympathize with him. Why is he doing what he's doing to the townsfolk? I mean, the episode made it very clear that he's not supposed to harm innocents and that he's only after Jex. So why does he spend a big deal of his screen time trying to hurt innocents and not going after Jex?
And you know what? I actually have a solution to this. Jex could have used his ship as a generator to create a force field around Mercy that prevents mechanical creatures from entering. There. Done. Sure, it's sci-fi mumbo-jumbo, but it makes the Gunslinger a much simpler and effective character because we understand why he can't enter the town, but he can also prevent food and resources from coming into the force field by stopping them before they pass by into the town. Normal people can get past the barrier, but the cyborg can't get in. And you can have your big confrontation at the end because they lower the barrier to let the cyborg in and have Jex escape while he's distracted. Okay, done. You want that one, BBC? Call me. I'll write a script for you. Okay, so the two big characters of this episode don't make a lick of sense, but the character that is hurt the most is easily the Doctor. The Doctor is a character who respects all life. He believes in forgiveness. Let's not forget that this guy was going to allow the Daleks to start again in Series 3. Sure, it was really, really dumb there and it wasn't a very good story, but he still allowed it to happen. He believes in forgiveness, so... why the hell did he kick Jex out of the town and pull a freaking gun on him? I mean, he pulled a gun on the general in the Doctor's daughter, but that was because he killed his generated anomaly of a daughter. What did Jex do to provoke this sort of reaction? Now, I'm going to play the clip, unedited, of when he snaps. And keep in mind, the Doctor knows what Jex did and was able to keep a level-headed attitude until this moment.
Looking at you, Doctor, is like looking into a mirror. Almost. There's rage there, like me. Guilt, like me. Solitude. Everything but the nerve to do what needs to be done. Thank the gods my people weren't relying on you to save them.
No! No! But these people are out! Out! Out!
Okay. What was so special about that encounter? The Doctor has had dozens of talking down to's before. Many of them were much worse than this, so what happened there? Then the Doctor gets a lecture from Amy.
We could end this right now. We could save everyone right now.
This is not how we roll, and you know it. What's happened to you, Doctor? When did killing someone become an option?
Jex has to answer for his crimes.
And what then? Are you going to hunt down everyone who's made a gun or a bullet or a bomb?
But they keep coming back, don't you see? Every time I negotiate, I try to understand. Well, not today, no. Today, I honour the victims first. His, the Masters, the Daleks, all the people who died because of my mercy.
See, this is what happens when you travel alone for too long. Well, listen to me, Doctor. We can't be like him. We have to be better than him.
But the Doctor already knows that they have to be better than this. This is massively out of character for him. The Doctor is someone who values human life, and normally he wouldn't think twice about saving Jex. You could literally take this entire scene out, and you would have the same story. And travelling alone? This isn't the 2009 specials where the Doctor has to be on his own. We're 3 episodes into Series 7, and not only did he create a gang last week, but we've seen him constantly pick up Amy and Rory. This exchange holds so little weight within the context of the series, and believe it or not, this is the only thing Amy exists to do in this episode. So the only reason the companions are in this story doesn't work. Why are Amy and Rory even here? Even if Toby was so desperate to keep this scene in, he wouldn't need Amy to be the one to deliver it. Isaac could have done it. Yeah, just reword it a little bit and there you go. You've got the dilemma of the Doctor going against Isaac, the Sheriff, and then it would make sense for Isaac to pass on the torch to the Doctor, and it would be more profound because the Doctor got Isaac killed and he's trying to continue his legacy. I don't know how I'm thinking of this stuff at the top of my head, but there you go. But anyway, Amy and Rory do nothing in this episode, which makes me wonder why they're even here. I'm not even going to talk about their characters like I normally do in my reviews, because their presence is non-existent, and with the exception of this scene, and like I said before, this scene has no place being here in the first place.
Remember, Amy and Rory aren't actual companions right now, when in the strictest sense, the Doctor just picks them up every now and again. So you don't need to have them in the story. They're not a permanent part of the TARDIS crew. So why are they here? What are they doing? If your companions only exist in a story to give the Doctor a 1 minute talking down to, you're doing it wrong.
The townsfolk also don't seem to make much sense in this episode. The opening does a great job at establishing a mystery as the townsfolk are afraid of the alien Doctors, but as we discover later, they already know who the Gunslinger is after.
But Isaac, it could be him.
You know it ain't.
Why is this episode pointing out its own plot hole? There's also the scene where the Doctor confronts the teenager outside of the saloon about letting Jex go, and throughout it, I had one constant question.
Why aren't they just talking this through?
The townsfolk and the TARDIS crew don't even consider stopping to talk. Not for a second. Everyone here instantly resorts to a confrontation. There's no negotiations, no attempts at compromise, nothing. In a plot that's trying to make a complex moral decision, the characters sure are simple-minded, and that scene with the Doctor and the teenager, it just seems like it's trying to recreate the sniper scene from the Happiness Patrol, but it's not nearly as powerful.
Hello. Back. Use the gun.
Yes, I imagine he will. You like guns, don't you?
This is a specialized weapon. It's designed for roof duty, designed for long range. I've never used one up close before.
Let him go.
No!
No. In fact, let him come a little closer.
So here you are.
Why? Scared? Why should you be scared? You're the one with the gun.
That's right.
And you like guns, don't you?
He'll kill you.
Of course he will. That's what guns are for. Pull a trigger, end a life. Simple, isn't it?
Yes.
Makes sense, doesn't it?
Yes.
A life killing life.
Who are you?
Shut up. Why don't you do it then? Look me in the eye. Pull the trigger, end my life.
No.
Why not?
I can't.
Why not?
I don't know.
Throw away your gun.
That's how all this started. Jex turned someone into a weapon. Now that same story is going to make you a killer too. Don't you see, violence doesn't end violence. It extends it. Now, I don't think you want to do this. I don't think you want to become that man.
Then there's the climax, where they try to paint the gunslinger as just as bad as Jex, but that's literally tacked on at the very, very end, and the debate has been far too one-sided in favour of Jex this whole time, that it doesn't even matter. Jex retreating to his ship at the end is only there to extend the climax, because he goes to kill himself anyway. Why didn't Jex just go out there and confront the gunslinger to ensure that the people pretending to be him didn't get killed in the crossfire? It just seems awfully risky for someone who knows he's going to his death anyway.
He behaved with honour at the end. Maybe more than me.
Honour? He risked the lives of everyone in the town just so he could die over an intercom. It would have been much more impactful, not to mention less cowardly, if he had met the gunslinger face to face to his death.
Like I said before, I respect everything this episode is going for, but it really just drops the ball in every possible way. So, you probably think that I hate this episode, don't you? Well, actually, no I don't. I mean, I hate the plot and I hate the morals, but the rest of it is pretty damn good across the board.
With the exception of his massively out-of-character actions in the second act, the Doctor really is great here, as is Matt Smith's performance. He's great at delivering classic British humour, and he's a joy to watch as he made me laugh from beginning to end.
Tea, but the strong stuff. Leave the bag in.
He shoots people's hats.
I think it was a warning shot.
Well, that's what happens when people get toast crumbs on the console.
He's called Joshua. It's from the Bible. It means the deliverer.
No, he isn't.
What?
I speak horse. He's called Susan. And he wants you to respect his life choices.
However, my Matt Smith moment of the week is a sequence that has absolutely no dialogue. So let's take a look at it. The Matt Smith moment of the week. The Matt Smith moment of the week. The scene where Matt Smith discovers who Jex really is powerful stuff, and the look on his face as he's reading the files, my god, that man can act. Also, I said I wouldn't talk about the companions in this episode, but I will say one thing.
You're a mother, aren't you?
How did you know?
There's kindness in your eyes, and sadness, but a ferocity too.
It wasn't exactly straightforward.
It seldom is.
Now, I know that this isn't Toby Whithouse's fault, but everything that happened between Amy and Rory in Asylum of the Daleks pretty much negates this entire conversation's impact.
You want kids! You have always wanted kids! Ever since you were a kid! And I can't have them! I can't ever give you children.
You got to raise me after all.
You're a mother, aren't you?
You see? You see what Pandora's box Stephen Moffat has opened when he introduced that bullshit divorce subplot? I mean, why was it there? Just so that he could have a bit of family drama in the first episode? Pathetic. It seems like every episode since Asylum of the Daleks has somehow been hurt because of that divorce subplot. I mean,
anyway, moving on, the supporting cast are actually really good. I know that they're stock Western characters like the Vicar, the Undertaker, the Teenager, the Sheriff, etc., but the performances are really solid, and I really enjoyed the limited screen time from everyone in the cast. But there is one thing I will cry foul on, however. The episode starts with a narration from a woman, and then we never hear from the narrator again until the end, where we discover that it was the great-granddaughter of someone who we don't even know. Wow, thanks for that? Oh, and let's talk about that girl. When they're hiding from the gunslinger at the end, she just randomly stands up, walks across the room, and knocks over the books. Why? I know deep down, Toby, that you're a good writer, but there, you weren't even trying, were you? And despite Jex and the Gunslinger's characters not making a lick of sense, a huge amount of credit has to go to Adrian Scarborough and Andrew Brook for giving great performances. Andrew Brook in particular deserves massive props for performing under all that heavy makeup and costume. Speaking of which, this episode looks amazing. The director of last week's episode, Saul Metzstein, I don't know how to say that, so I'm not even going to bother trying, he returns here and he absolutely nails the Western motif. The camera work is phenomenal. The way he shoots the scenery and the wide expanse of shots are amazing. This guy really knows what he's doing, and he's taken the Western motif of this episode and absolutely ran with it. The episode was shot in Spain, where most famous spaghetti westerns are shot, and the location work definitely benefits the atmosphere. The sets are great, the costumes are great, and Murray Gold's music is phenomenal, and it adds so much to the presentation. The makeup effects are great as well, especially on the Gunslinger. He's a fantastic visual creation, and the sound of his impending footsteps and his silhouette in the background are sure to be some of the best aspects of Series 7 presentation-wise. In terms of how well made this episode is, it's without a doubt spectacular.
I'm really torn here, because I like almost everything this episode has to offer, except the most important part of the episode. And kudos to Toby Whithouse for trying to tackle this subject, but in the end, it just doesn't work.
The episode tries to be far too complex for its own good, and Toby just wasn't able to balance the complex themes he incorporated, which makes the episode appear too convoluted to believe in its own message. The two main characters here don't make a lick of sense, and as a result, I honestly didn't care about what happened to either of them. Not to mention, the companions were useless, and even the Doctor acted against everything the character stood for a few moments. Despite all these problems, they didn't cause me to hate the episode, it just came across as really hollow. This isn't me disliking it like I did Asylum of the Daleks, it just didn't do anything for me. The presentation and some genuinely great moments allowed me to enjoy the episode for some of its running time, but it just didn't work.
Now, I don't want you to think that I'm just a snobby critic who's deliberately trying to hate Doctor Who. I mean, I love Doctor Who. I'm not even going to go into this again. But I was able to watch this episode with my friend Jamie, and as soon as the credits rolled, me and him just looked at each other, and we were thinking the exact same thing. What was the Gunslinger's deal? Why did Jex go back to the ship at the end? What were we supposed to feel? What's the point of the narrator? What were Amy and Rory doing? And much, much more. So I know it's not just me. Well, Chris Chibnall's writing another script for next week's episode, The Power of Three, so hopefully he'll be able to pull it out of the bag again. That's all from me, and I shall see you guys next time.
At long last, it's Christmas!
Put it on your Christmas list!
Dad, I'm 31, I don't have a Christmas list anymore.
I do!
Anachronistic electricity keep out signs, aggressive stares. Has someone been peeking at my Christmas list?
Doctor!
Sorry, love, was I interrupting? More postcards from your dad.
Do you know what? I think it is the fitting.
You mean those things?
Trumpets!